Tonight's video will be accompanied by Twilight Bavarian Dark Lager from Black Wheat Brewing in Brandon, Manitoba. They describe it as a Bavarian-style dark lager with subtle notes of chocolate and espresso. Woohoo! Just the perfect thing for an evening video. Featuring a mild, roasty aroma with a smooth lager finish. That's quite nice. Not what I expected from a Bavarian. Anyway, today I am looking at this Pentax AF-160 camera flash unit. As far as I can tell, this is a 1990s camera flash. It would have been relatively commonly used with fairly inexpensive flash or film cameras. It'll work with, it doesn't need to be a Pentax camera to work with any camera. Runs on two AA cells, as I just inserted there. Unfortunately, this one I don't think works. I haven't been able to get it to work anyway, either with the test button or by triggering it the way the camera would. This would have mounted onto the hot shoe of on the top of a camera, and you see there's a couple of electrical contacts there, and then there's one more inside the sides of it. So that would essentially be your ground in the sides there, and the center one would trigger it if you connected it to the ground. And the other one is used variously by different camera manufacturers for signaling between the camera and the flash unit. This little chart on the back of here would have given you some indication as to distance versus lens setting versus the power setting of this guy. There is a little adjustment goes between these two dots, which I assume are different colors, but I can't see that because, of course, colorblind, and M, which I assume is manual mode. With manual mode, you would use this chart on the back here. With the other two modes, it would put the camera and flash in somewhat of communications with each other over that pin right there. But since the test button on the back of this thing doesn't do anything, and since shorting these two pins out doesn't do anything, which is, as I said, normally how the camera would trigger this, I'm going to guess this thing is dead. So, tear down it shall be. And I'm not too precious about this one because it's just one that I picked up in a thrift store a while back for a couple of dollars. Cheap because it doesn't work. I'm just going to cut right through that sticker, which is on the seam between the two halves of this. Maybe I should pry it up because it feels more metallic than that. Hang on. There we go. Aha! And that reveals two screws. And there are two other screws down on the bottom here. Really, really tiny Phillipses. So I'm going to guess that that's all that's holding this together. Fortunately, my various screwdriver sets have come with small Phillips. So I should have no trouble opening this. I hope. Loosening both of those screws has dropped out this little metal plate, which acts as sort of a nut between them. That was a little bit unexpected. Can I push those two screws out now, or are they captive? They don't want to come out. Okay, we'll carry on with these two down here. Or maybe just one of them. I guess it depends on what it screws into. That is a machine screw. Oh yeah, there we go. Two halves separating somewhat. Oh-ho! A monster capacitor inside. So that will be charged up through, I'm guessing, some sort of a boost circuit in there to probably hundreds of volts. Yeah, hundreds of volts. It's a 350-volt capacitor. So that will be charged up, as I said, through some sort of a boost circuit slowly. And then when the thing is triggered, it will dump that voltage, that hundreds of volts, out and into the xenon flash tube, which is up in here. Where is it? There it is. Let me just finish yanking this stuff out. Actually, before I do that, I want to discharge that capacitor. I'm not entirely sure, but I think it's possible that capacitor is holding a charge. No, 75 volts. Not enough to hurt me too bad, but definitely enough to do something. Whoa. There, discharged. Yeah. I didn't want that to happen on my finger. And that's also why I used a really cheap old meter rather than one of my better ones. So a bit of foam that was holding stuff in. There's the test button. Like I said, I'm not concerned if this doesn't go back together because it wasn't working anyway. And it's old and I have other flashes that I would rather use if I was going to be doing film photography. So in here, we have the xenon flash tube. It is in construction. It is similar to a neon tube. It is a glass tube with electrodes at each end, there and there. And it contains, you know, in this case, xenon gas. The capacitor will be putting a voltage across the two main terminals of this guy. And then when you trigger it, this third wire, which one is it? Actually, this one here, probably, which is wrapped around the outside of the glass, it will give a kick of voltage through this inductor here, probably. That looks like what it's attached to, which will give a boost and a voltage spike, which will be enough to cause this thing to start conducting. And it will conduct that spark through the xenon gas and create a light very briefly. And the rest of this is just going to be triggering, charging, and various other things. So there will be an oscillator in here, I'm guessing, as part of the boost circuit. Notice that this is quite old technology. There's no ICs in here. There's 1, 2, 3 diodes that I can spot. That looks like a fourth one over there. No, it's not. That's an old carbon film resistor. Wow. That is a transistor in a metal can with a little flag heatsink on it. There's one other transistor there. Lower power than this one, just a standard transistor. We have these old, I think those are mica capacitors. Wow. Another inductor over there. This is an interesting little component. It looks to me like it should be an overvoltage protection device. Well, I'm not sure. It has two contacts going down there in parallel with the capacitor. So yeah, it probably is. But it has a sort of a middle contact that goes off to this inductor. So maybe it's a transformer? Huh, I don't know. I've never seen one of those guys. To me, like I said, it just looks like an overvoltage protection device. But leave it in the comments if you know what that guy really is. Unfortunately, back in these days, they didn't label components on the board. You were expected to have a service manual or know exactly what you're doing. Here is that test button that was on the back. It goes over this little metal flap here, and it's got a hole in it. When you test it, you basically connect this metal piece onto that post there, which triggers it. And that, I'm guessing, is in parallel with, yeah, that is in parallel with the hot shoe contacts. But behind that, through that hole, is that neon bulb. It will be probably in parallel with the voltage on the capacitor. When that gets over its threshold and the threshold of its circuit, that indicates to you that the flash is ready to go, and therefore indicates that the capacitor is full enough to trigger the flash to go. Interesting to note that all these resistor leads are sleeved. And they're all sitting vertically just to try and cram more stuff in there. This is, of course, in the days before surface mount was available or affordable. So to cram more stuff in, you put your resistors vertically. And because there are some moderately higher voltages in here, and you just don't want things splashing around anyway, most of those leads are sleeved. Very cool. You don't see that much anymore.
Here's a schematic of a much more basic camera flash unit. It's got a lot of the same, you know, block diagram bits, but it's much more simplified. This particular one comes from one of those disposable cardboard cameras you used to be able to get. You push this switch to start the charging, that creates an oscillation through the transistors and the primary of this transformer. That oscillation gets stepped up through this transformer. gets rectified through this diode into DC. That higher voltage, much higher voltage, is on here, and it charges the main capacitor. It charges this smaller capacitor over here, slower through the 1 meg resistor, and it also presents a voltage across this neon bulb and its current limiting resistor. Once that voltage gets over the turn-on threshold for this neon, it lights up, letting you know that you're ready to take your picture. Then you push the shutter button on the camera, which closes this switch, discharging this capacitor rapidly through the primary of this transformer. And again, we have a huge ratio of turns. The secondary side is a very high voltage and at a very, a quick spike. That quick spike of voltage causes the gas to conduct, and that conducting gas discharges the big capacitor through the conducting gas rapidly, converting all those electrons into photons, and there's your flash.
If you want to know more about how xenon flashes work, I've got a video that I did a long time ago, I'll put it up there, that is about a strobe light, which is essentially a xenon tube, still has the high voltage power supply, but instead of being triggered manually or remotely, it has an oscillator that just triggers every, however often the oscillator is set for. It's a much more simple circuit than this. It was just sold as a consumer product rather than something. I mean, this wasn't an expensive or high-end flash unit, but it was still a flash unit that a serious beginning photographer might use, as opposed to just a party strobe light like that video, that other video is about. Well, thanks for stopping by just for this basic, simple little teardown. Like I said, I wasn't planning on doing a full reverse engineering of this board. I was just curious to see what was inside there, and if there's anything obvious blown up or damaged. If one of those capacitors was blown, maybe I would have replaced it, but I don't think it was. And this big guy obviously still holds power, and it still had 70 some volts and a hell of a lot of current that it was able to wallop out of there when we shorted it. Anyway, questions and comments down below as usual. If you were a photographer back in the day and you used one of these things, it'd be interesting to hear if you know how old it is. I found a manual online from the 90s, so maybe that's when it was from. I'm not sure. Anyway, thanks for watching. I'll talk to you later.